الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين وافضل الصلاة واتم التسليم على سيدنا رسول الله وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم أجمعين. I was scheduled to actually speak after my friend Iman Badawi. She was speaking on Khadija رضي الله عنها. And I was thinking while I was preparing this talk how difficult it is for anyone to speak after we have all heard about Khadija رضي الله عنها. So قدر الله ما شاء فعل. And I get to speak first, so alhamdulillah. And my topic is no other than the most prominent wife of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam after Khadija, and she is Aisha radiallahu anha. And it was actually, if we look at the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, it was his nature to make people around him feel that they were the most beloved person to him. So whoever came into contact with the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the impression they got from him was that I am the most beloved to the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So this emboldened people, gave them so much confidence that actually one of the ashaba by the name of Amr bin al-As, he actually felt emboldened enough to ask the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, who is the most beloved of all people to you? Ayyu an-nas ahabbu ilayk? And he felt that the Prophet ﷺ was actually going to say you. He actually was expecting this answer. So when he asked that question, the answer he got from the Prophet ﷺ was actually Aisha radiallahu anha, which means that the Prophet ﷺ answered him that Aisha is the most beloved to me of all the people. And he said, Min al-rijal, I meant among the men. And he answered, now again he was hoping that he would be the one who would be the most, who was the most beloved to him. And the Prophet ﷺ answered, Abiha, which means her father. Now, the Prophet ﷺ is referring to Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, but he didn't say Abu Bakr. He actually referenced Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu through Aisha, again highlighting the extent of love that he had for her. Now, we notice that when you look at the ahadith that Aisha radiallahu anhu has transmitted to us in the Sunnah, thousands of ahadith, you see the Sahaba refer to her in a very, very honorable title that actually no one else has. They say, like when we, in English we translate it, on the authority of such and such narrator. In Arabic it actually, for Aisha radiallahu anha, it is حَدَّثَنِي الصِّدِّيقَ بِنْتُ الصِّدِّيقِ حَبِيبَةُ حَبِيبِ اللَّهِ أَلْمُبَرَّأَ فِي كِتَابِ اللَّهِ, which means that I narrate to you on the authority of الصِّدِّيقَ, the truthful, بِنْتُ الصِّدِّيقِ, the daughter of the truthful, referring to Abu Bakr. Habibatu Habibillah, the beloved of the beloved of Allah. Al-Mubarra'a fi kitabillah, the one who was exonerated, yani her innocence was made clear from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in his book, when Aisha radiallahu anha was cleared of the false accusations that were made against her. No one else has this description, the entire sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And you know, to get an idea of the kind of impact she's had globally, just look at the number of women that carry her name today. In all parts of the globe, you know, from Africa to Europe, every continent, and not just now, but throughout all these centuries of Islam, countless women have carried her name to the point that it probably is the most popular single Muslim woman name. And actually she, when we talk about her, it's very difficult to go through every aspect of her personality and contributions, but one of the things we find about her is she was one of the few wives of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam who had actually committed the whole Qur'an to memory. She had actually memorized the whole Qur'an. And others included Hafsa and Salama. And she was the one in whose presence the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam received the most revelation. No one else, in the presence of no other wife, did the Prophet ﷺ receive as much revelation as he did in the presence of Aisha radiallahu anha. To the point that even when they were together in bed, you would have Jibreel alayhi salam descend to them in that state. So subhanAllah, no one else has the honor that Aisha radiallahu anha has, again showing Allah's pleasure with her. And in fact, Jibreel alayhi salam, he himself used to extend his salams to her. And the Prophet ﷺ would say to Ya Aisha, هَذَا جِبْرِيلِ يُقْرَوَ عَلَيْكِ السَّلَامِ, that, oh Aisha, this is Jibreel and he's saying salam to you. And she would answer, وَعَلَيْكُمَ السَّلَامِ وَرَحْمَةُ اللَّهِ وَبَرَكَاتُهُ. And once it so happened that after one of the battles, the battle of Ahzab, Aisha radiallahu anh saw someone wearing a yellow imamah, a yellow turban. And she noticed that man, and the Prophet ﷺ then later told her that in fact that was, it was Jibreel. So she was actually the only wife of the Prophet ﷺ who had actually seen Jibreel in his human form. She narrated a total of 2,210 ahadith. This is a massive portion of our deen we get from Aisha radiallahu anha. If you look at Bukhari, it's about 6,000 narrations. So this is an incredible, significant contribution of Aisha radiallahu anha. Actually, she's number four in the top narrators of hadith. You have Abu Huraira, Ibn Umar, Anas bin Malik, and the number four is Aisha radiallahu anha. And Bukhari and Muslim both carry her narrations as well as the other sahih books of ahadith. If we look at the Qur'an and Sunnah and study through it, the various righteous people throughout history that have been accused of adultery, we find the names of Maryam, alayhi salam. She was accused of adultery. Who was it that made it clear to all the people that in fact she was innocent? It was Isa, alayhi salam, right? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave her the power to speak as a child, and she was thus exonerated, yani freed of the accusation. And then we also see the example of Yusuf, alayhi salam. He was also a righteous person who was accused of adultery in his years of early manhood. And who was it that exonerated him? It was actually Imratu Aziz, the wife of Aziz, who finally at the end confessed that he was innocent of the charge that was being brought forth. But who was it that exonerated Aisha radiallahu anha when she was in fact accused of adultery also? It was none other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, who in the Qur'an revealed verses about her, exonerating her and freeing her, and actually taking the believers to task who had actually participated in this rumor and scandal against her. No one else has this distinction of being freed of these types of accusations by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala himself. Now if we talk a little bit about Aisha, it really starts with her parents. This is the foundation of her goodness, the tarbiyah that she received. She was actually the daughter of, as we know, Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, and her mother is Rumman. The Prophet had living nicknames for Aisha. He used to call her Humaira because she had a reddish tinge to her skin. And Habra in Arabic refers to redness. So Humaira is the diminutive female form of that. And he also had another nickname for her, showing the extent of affection that he had, and he used to call her Aish. And again, going back to her parents, because it's really hard to understand all of the virtue and the tarbiyah that she received if we don't know about her parents. We start with her mother, Rumman bint Amir. The Prophet ﷺ said about the mother of Aisha, Rumman, "Man sarrahu an yandhura ila imra'a min al-hur al-'ayn falyandhur ila Rumman." That whoever is pleased to see one of the women of paradise, let him look to Rumman. Let him look to the mother of Aisha, Rumman. And actually when, after this whole scandal of if the Rumman, the mother of Aisha radiallahu anha, passed away, the Prophet actually went to her grave and said, "Allahumma lam yakhfi alayka ma laqiyat Rumman fika wa fi rasulik." He went to the grave of Rumman and said, "Oh Allah, it is not hidden from you what Rumman has achieved, yani in status, with you and with the Prophet, with his messenger, with the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam." Yani she had achieved such a high station, such a high ranking with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam through her Islam, through her actions and her iman. And her father, of course, needs no introduction. Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, whose kunya is Abu Quhafa, and his name is Abdullah bin Uthman. You know the Prophet ﷺ said about him, "وَلَوْ كُنْتُ مُتَّخِذَ خَلِيلًا مِنْ عُمَّتِي لَتَّخَذْتُ أَبَا بَكْرُ." That if I were to take a close, intimate associate, a deep, beloved friend from the Ummah, it would have been Abu Bakr. And he was the only choice for the Prophet ﷺ. No one came closer to that level of relationship that they had. And when we see Aisha radiallahu anha, she is growing up in this household. She is only 6 years old when she's engaged to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and she's married to him at the age of 9. Now, we know what a tremendous impact the company that one keeps has on one's personality and spirituality. So we want to look into the household of Aisha radiallahu anha. What kind of influences were present in her house that were shaping this young child and her young mind? Who are the friends that were coming to the house of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam? Unlike many of the Sahaba, Aisha is one of the few Sahaba who grew up in Islam, whose both parents were Muslim. from the very beginning. Many of them became Muslim in their 40s or 50s. Many of them had to invite their parents to Islam. Many of them were not accepted by their parents when they became Muslim. You have so many painful stories of the Sahaba that were rejected, even by their own parents. Aisha radiallahu anha is one of those special cases where she sees her parents from a young age in Islam, memorizing Quran, and being frequented by the most righteous people that walked the face of the earth at that time. Who was the visitor who used to come morning and evening to the house of Abu Bakr radiallahu anha regularly as Aisha radiallahu anha was growing up? It was none other than the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He was a regular visitor, a frequenter of the house of Abu Bakr radiallahu anha. So this is the house, this is the environment, this is the tarbiyah she's receiving from the very, very beginning. So we see she grows up in the house of Siddiq radiallahu anha, and her tarbiyah culminates in the house of Al-Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So what kind of, you know, of an impact is this going to have, and what kind of an individual is going to be produced when they have these two unbelievable monumental influences on her life? This really was the hikmah, the wisdom of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He was preparing her for the role that she was going to diligently fulfill with such beauty as she did. I want to talk a little bit about the age of Aisha radiallahu anha when she got married, because I know all of you are bombarded as young Muslims with all the Islamophobia and all the other different types of taunts and attacks that the Prophet is subjected to. This is one of the things that always comes up, is the age of Aisha radiallahu anha when she got married to the Prophet, right? She was 9 years old. Now, first of all, if some of you are still shocked or by that or find it unsettling, the first thing we have to do is leave our cultural prejudices at the door. If we really want to understand the situation, we kind of have to, you know, go back to the time and understand the cultural context of the age. And this is one of the basic premises of any objective anthropological study, is that you can't superimpose the standards of your own culture on another custom, another culture, on another tradition. You kind of have to look at them in a fair and honest way. It is completely acceptable social practice in Hartford, Connecticut today in 2011 may not be socially tolerable at all in a small village in Uganda, even today. So, as Dr. Jonathan Brown, he's actually a specialist in hadith, he teaches in Georgetown University. He's extensively traveled the Muslim world, and one of the things we learned from him is that he speaks strongly about the validity of cultural relativism, which means that the more you travel and, you know, the more you're exposed to the different cultures and traditions of different people, the more you can appreciate the broad spectrum of what is considered normal and acceptable social behavior, and how that changes and varies tremendously from time to time and place to place. So keeping that in mind, in Arabia at the time, as soon as a girl attained the age of puberty, she was considered marriageable. It was perfectly fine for her to get married. This was the norm for them. And interesting to note, even here in the States, in many parts of the world that we are exposed to, the standards we are used to, until 1886, the age of consent was 6 years old. Same as the age of Aisha radiallahu anha when she got engaged. And even in Massachusetts, till this day, the age of consent is 12. So, subhanAllah, yani, you will see this broad spectrum and cultural relativism which we refer to. And how is it that the marriage of the Prophet to Aisha took place? Was he pursuing her? Was he seeking her hand in marriage? In fact, Aisha radiallahu anha was suggested to the Prophet by another Sahabi by the name of Khawla. Khawla was the one who said to the Prophet, you know, why don't you marry Sauda, an older woman, or you can marry Aisha. And the Prophet actually said no. He said, I'm not going to marry Aisha at this time, and rather what he did is he married Sauda. But Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu is the one who actually pursued this matter further. He went to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and asked and proposed for Aisha radiallahu anhu. And in fact, even then, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was not ready at that point. And it wasn't later, until Aisha was a little bit older, that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam in fact accepted. And this was because of a dream he had. He had a dream three times where Jibreel alayhi salam actually came to him, and he had someone wrapped in a garment of green silk, And then had the face of this person was unveiled before the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and he saw that it was Aisha radiallahu anha. And the Jibreel was telling him that this is your wife. And he had this dream three times, so he was under religious mandate to marry Aisha radiallahu anha, and this is how the nikah took place. So who is really the one arranging the marriage? It's no one other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, for this great hikmah, this great wisdom that he had in mind. Now, Aisha radiallahu anha, because she got married at such a young age, her mind was very impressionable. And someone with such a young, fresh mind is able to retain and absorb and preserve for much longer time than someone else who is older and not able to have that level of retention and memorization. So this is really the hikmah and the wisdom which allowed her to convey the prophetic legacy which she so accurately and intimately was able to do. So no, none of you should ever feel squirm in your seat or feel uncomfortable or unsettled about her age. It should be very clear in your mind why and how it happened and the divine wisdom that we have 2,210 hadith to prove it with. Now, we'll talk a little bit about the knowledge of Aisha radiallahu anha. She was truly the greatest student among the wives of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. In fact, when the Sahaba, the senior Sahaba, were disagreeing among themselves about a matter, they would say, okay, let's go to the one who's going to clarify the matter for us. And they were referring to Aisha radiallahu anha. And they said that there was nothing that we would ask her about, وَجَدْنَا عِنْدَهَا مِنْهُ عِلْمًا, except that we would find some knowledge that she had about any matter that we would ask her about. And the Masruq, one of the great Tabi'in from the generation that came after the Prophet ﷺ, he said, لَقَدْ رَأَيْنَا أَكَاذِرٌ مِنْ صَحَابَةِ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمْ يَسْأَلُونَ عَيْشَ عَنِ الْفَرَائِنِ, that we saw the senior companions of the Prophet ﷺ asking Aisha radiallahu anha about the matters of the deen. And Urwa is actually the son of Asma bint Abi Bakr. So he is the nephew of Aisha radiallahu anha. And he was also one of Aisha's greatest students. So he's the great nephew student of Aisha radiallahu anha. And he says, مَا رَأَيْتُ أَحَدًا مِنَ النَّاسِ أَعْلَمُ بِالْقُرْآنِ وَلَا بِفَرِيدًا وَلَا بِحَلَالٍ وَلَا بِحَرَامٍ وَلَا بِشِعْرٍ وَلَا بِحَدِيثِ الْعَرَبِ وَلَا بِنَصْرٍ مِنْ عَيْشَ رَضِيَ اللَّهُ عَنْهَا. And Urwa, her nephew, said that I have not seen anyone from among the people more knowledgeable about the Qur'an, more knowledgeable about the fara'id, more knowledgeable about the halal, the haram, poetry, about the akhbar of the Arabs at the time, about genealogy, than Aisha radiallahu anha. So she was able to have expertise in many different fields, and it wasn't just limited to one area. She in fact taught 88 different scholars. She was teaching fiqh about the Friday prayer, about the qasr of the salah, about the ahkam of fasting. In fact, she would teach thousands of people in hajj, when the great delegations would come from all over, and this is obviously the greatest human gathering at one time and one place. It was Aisha radiallahu anha that was teaching the masses from behind the curtain. And you know, we can really appreciate her extreme intelligence when you look at the life, the amount of time she spent with the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Only 8 to 9 years she was married to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, but she lived for 50 years after his death. So subhanAllah, it's very clear that Allah had chosen her for a specific task at the peak of her intelligence, youth, memory, retention, so that she would be able to live a lot longer to convey this deen to us and to teach the thousands, as she did till this day. We have her narrations preserved and continue to be guided through them. And notice, for us women to learn, is that in those prophetic years, she wasn't wasting her time. And that 8-9 years, short years that she had with the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, she wasn't wasting her time in things that would be of no consequence after she died. Rather, she was contributing to a legacy that was larger than her life itself. And this is what she left behind. And how did she do this? Two things: an inquisitive mind and an activist spirit. She was not shy to ask what she didn't understand. And this knowledge, she converted into eloquence and conveying the message, conveying that knowledge. And in fact, when she would argue with the people, she would win the argument, and the Prophet would be so proud of her and say, this is the daughter of Abu Bakr. She is the daughter of Abu Bakr, radiallahu anhu. The other thing about Aisha is her activist spirit. She wasn't content just to, you know, be on the sidelines. She was out there in the battlefield. She was nursing the wounded. She was tending to the sick. She was paying attention. She was witnessing and participating in the affairs of the Ummah. And this is really what an ideal Muslim woman has to be like. Someone who's involved and out there and shaping and shaking things around her. And this is why she was able to memorize Quran and pass on thousands of hadith and contribute to the discourse of fiqh and fatawa. And this requires the highest level of specialization and expertise. What I want to say in the few minutes that we have left, the Prophet said about Aisha, إِنَّ فَضْلَ عَيْشَ عَلَى النِّسَى كَفَضْلَ الثَّرِيدَ عَلَى سَائِرَ الطَّعَامِ, that the fadl or the virtue of Aisha over all of the women is like the fadl of al-thareed on the rest of the food. And al-thareed was actually a type of very wholesome, nutritious soup in the time of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, which in and of itself, it constituted an entire meal. When the day you had al-thareed for dinner, you didn't have to have anything else. It didn't need a side dish. So the point of the hadith is that Aisha radiallahu anha is the complete package. She is the complete woman. She combines the taqwa, the knowledge, the activism, the spirituality. That is what embodies a true ideal Muslim woman. Now, you know, all of this amazing knowledge that she had, it has to lead to something. You know, all of us come to these conferences every year and we learn so much knowledge, but if we don't really translate that into action and behavior, it's just information, like a donkey carrying books. So what are the real fruits of the knowledge that's shown forth in the character of Aisha radiallahu anha? And that's none other than, number one, her zuhud. Her zuhud, yani her lack of attachment to the dunya. After you have knowledge of the dunya, the logical response is that you don't attach yourself to it. And this is how she subsisted in the time of the Prophet without complaining. They said that they used to live on, no fire would be in their house for months, and they subsisted basically on al-aswadan, water and dates. You know the famous narration. And she, even afterwards, was much given to fasting. She would choose actually the longest, hottest day of the year to fast, because she understood that the reward is going to be proportioned to the diligence and effort put behind it. And once when the Muslims afterwards became, you know, quite rich and affluent, at the time of Muawiyah radiallahu anhu, she was given a gift of 100,000 dirham, and she was fasting that day. And the day did not end until she had distributed the entire 100,000 dirham to the poor and the needy. And her servant came to her and said, you know, if you had just kept one dirham for yourself to buy something for your iftar, you don't even have food to break your fast with, if you had just kept one dirham out of the 100,000 dirham. And look at her response. She said, لو كنت تذكرتيني لفعلت, that, oh, if you had reminded me, I would have done that. She didn't even remember that she has a need of her own to fulfill in a few hours. This is the true Zahida. This is someone who is completely detached, completely disinterested in dunya and what it has to offer. Another great quality of Aisha radiallahu anha is her humility. Now, when, although she had this distinguished status among the wives of the Prophet and the painful incident of her being accused of adultery took place, she actually narrates her own story of that painful time in her life. It was probably the most painful time in her life before the death of the Prophet ﷺ. She said that out of her humility, she said, I never thought that Qur'an would actually be revealed about me. She said, in her own words, لَشَأْنِي فِي نَفْسِي كَانَ أَحْقَرُ أَن يَتَكَلَّمَ اللَّهُ فِيَّ بِأَمْرٍ يُتْلَى. She said, I thought of myself as so insignificant that I never thought it possible that actually Allah would speak about me in verses that were going to be recited. But what she was hoping for was a dream that the Prophet ﷺ would have, where Allah would tell him that she's free of what they're accusing her of. But subhanAllah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala honored her because of this humility with ayat, verses that are going to be recited till the day of judgment, eternalizing her mention, her purity, and her innocence. And subhanAllah, this is exactly the meaning of the hadith, which says, مَنْ تَوَعَدَ عَلَى اللَّهِ رَفَعَهُ اللَّهُ, that one who lowers him or herself for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allah raises them up. Because she was so humble, look at the way Allah honored her in a way that no other person had achieved. The next thing I want to briefly talk about in the 5 minutes we have left, Okay, inshallah. I think we have 0 minutes left. Just a little bit about her, the way she supported other women in the field of knowledge. She had many, many female students. In fact, she had like a madrasa in Medina where she was, you know, teaching thousands. And she used to praise the women of the Ansar that they did not let their shyness obstruct them from gaining knowledge. That they were, this is their shyness, although they were women of haya, this was not the type of haya that was blameworthy, that would actually prevent them from learning. Unfortunately, I have to skip a lot and just, inshallah, go to the end, where we want to talk about her contribution in preserving the last dying moments of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. When the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was in the final days of his sickness, you know, he used to give a turn to his wives. One day he would be with one wife, and the next day would be someone else's turn. So he was asking, "Aina ana ghadan? Aina ana ba'da ghadan? You know, where am I going to be tomorrow? Where am I going to be after tomorrow?" The wives understood that he wants to be in the house of Aisha radiallahu anha in this final days of his sickness. So they graciously gave up their turns and he came to Aisha radiallahu anha. And she's the one who preserved the final dying moments of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and narrated us to them, something everybody would want to know the details of. And what happened at that time, in those moments that led up to his death, she's the one who told us that as his head was on her chest, as his soul was about to be taken from her lap, and he was buried in her house, this was an honor that no one had except Aisha radiallahu anha. And she's the one who related to us the last words of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. What were his last words? إِلَى رَفِيكَ الْعَلَى إِلَى رَفِيكَ الْعَلَى, which means to the highest company, to the supreme company, because you know prophets are given a choice at the time of their death between dunya and akhirah, and they're shown their place in paradise. After seeing that, no one chooses dunya. So the Prophet ﷺ said, إِلَى رَفِيكَ الْعَلَى إِلَى رَفِيكَ الْعَلَى, and then his hand fell. And she knew that the Prophet ﷺ, between her chest and lap in her house, he fell. It was only her, she says, and the angel of death. At that time, at that last moment of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, you know, at that point when his soul left this world sallallahu alaihi wasallam, a whole era of her life was over. That 8-9 years she has spent with the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, they were gone forever, and her grief was overwhelming. But in the aftermath of the anguish that lingered long after those final painful moments, she was able to productively channel the memories of her years with her husband, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, in the most valuable and the most lasting manner. Until more than 50 years later, on Tuesday the 17th of Ramadan, in the 57th year of the Hijrah, at the age of 66, Aisha radiallahu anha was also recalled back to the one who had recalled her husband 50 years earlier. On her deathbed, she was visited by someone, and she didn't want to meet the visitor because she was afraid he would praise her because she was dying. And she was very careful in what she said. He asked her, "How are you?" And she said, "I'm okay as long as I fear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala." Her salatul janazah was led by Abu Huraira radiallahu anhu, who was the top narrator of hadith, who used to go to Aisha radiallahu anha when he disputed with another sahabi over an issue. He's the one who led her janazah. She was buried at night in the Jannat al-Baqi'. And it is said that on that occasion, on that night, there were never that many people seen at night on the streets of Medina than the day that the beloved of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was buried. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala help us to emulate the likes of Aisha radiallahu anha and make her proud and the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam pleased with us the day we meet them. Subhanakallahumma bihamdika la ilaha illa ant, nastaghfiruka wa natubu ilayk. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.